Hello. In this video, we will study the so-called spectral theorem for operators which are both self-adjoint and compact. As background motivation, we recall that on the finite dimensional Euclidean space Cn, a Hermitian matrix has the spectral decomposition, which allows the matrix A to be expressed completely in terms of its eigenvalues and orthonormal eigenvectors. The decomposition shows that the image Ax of any vector x is a linear combination of the eigenvectors of A, and the coefficients are given by inner products between x and the eigenvector times the corresponding eigenvalue lambda k. In particular, since Ax can be expressed as a linear combination of Ek, the eigenvectors which correspond to non-zero eigenvalues lambda k form an orthonormal basis of the range of A. Our goal here is to show that all compact self-adjoint operators on Hilbert spaces have a similar spectral decomposition, but with possibly infinite number of terms, depending on whether or not the operator T has finite or infinite number of non-zero eigenvalues. Our main result states that every compact self-adjoint operator on a Hilbert space does indeed have a spectral decomposition with very similar structure. More precisely, for every x, the image Tx can be expressed as a possibly infinite linear combination of an orthonormal set of vectors Ek, and the coefficients of the linear combination have the same form as in the case of Hermitian matrices. In addition, the vectors Ek are orthonormal eigenvectors corresponding to the non-zero eigenvalues lambda k of T. In the spectral decomposition, the eigenvalues of T, which are all real due to the self-adjointness of T, can be organized so that their sizes form a non-increasing sequence. The theorem tells us that in this sequence, every non-zero eigenvalue is repeated at most finite number of times, and if T has an infinite number of non-zero eigenvalues, then the sequence of eigenvalues converges to zero as k goes to infinity. This result demonstrates that compact self-adjoint operators have a quite similar structure compared to diagonalizable matrices, and more precisely Hermitian matrices, with the main exception being that zero may be an accumulation point of the eigenvalues of T, or an eigenvalue with an infinite number of linearly independent eigenvectors, or possibly even both of these things. Finally, we can note that this result is typically presented in the more general case of compact and normal operators. The operator T being normal is defined as the property that the adjoint of T composed with T is the same as the operator T composed with its adjoint. Alternatively expressed, this condition requires that the operator T commutes with its adjoint. This is a strictly more general than self-adjointness of T, and also in the more general situation, the operator T has a spectral decomposition resembling the one that we have in our theorem. But the form of the decomposition has certain important differences due to the fact that if T is not self-adjoint, then the eigenvectors of T do not need to form an orthonormal set, and also the eigenvalues of T do not need to be real. We can now sketch the main parts of the proof of the spectral theorem. We begin with the construction of the sequence of eigenvalues lambda k. Since T is a compact and self-adjoint operator, our earlier results imply that every non-zero spectral point of T is real and an eigenvalue of T. And this eigenvalue has a finite number of linearly independent eigenvectors. Because of this, lambda k's form a countable set, and we can organize them starting with an eigenvalue with the largest absolute value to a sequence where each eigenvalue is repeated according to the number of linearly independent eigenvectors associated to this eigenvalue, and the sizes of the eigenvalues are decreasing. This way, we get a countable set of lambda k's, and if the number of these non-zero eigenvalues is infinite, then the sequence converges to zero, since zero is the only possible accumulation point of the spectrum of a compact operator. In the second step of the proof, we construct the set of vectors Ek. For every eigenvalue lambda k, the compactness of T implies that the kernel lambda k I minus T, consisting of the eigenvectors related to lambda k, is finite dimensional. Because of this, every one of these kernels has an orthonormal basis which we can construct, for example, using the Gram-Schmidt process. We then choose the set of vectors Ek to consist of these orthonormal basis vectors of each of the kernels, beginning with the eigenvalue lambda 1 and listing all the basis vectors of this subspace one after another. Since all the eigenvalues of the sequence of lambda k's were repeated according to the dimension of the associated kernel, we arrive at a situation where the sequence of eigenvalues of lambda k's has exactly the same number of repeated eigenvalues as the sequence of Ek's has basis vectors corresponding to the associated space of eigenvectors. By construction, for each k, the vector Ek belongs to the kernel lambda ki minus t, and therefore Ek is indeed an eigenvector corresponding to lambda k for every index k. Finally, since we chose the vectors Ek from orthonormal basis of the kernels, these vectors are normalized and orthogonal with respect to all other basis vectors of the same kernel. But since T is self-adjoint, we also know that the eigenvectors corresponding to distinct eigenvalues are always orthogonal, and because of this, the full set of vectors Ek is also orthogonal and therefore orthonormal as well. At this point, we have constructed the sequence lambda k of eigenvalues and a corresponding orthonormal set of eigenvectors Ek, which have the basic properties stated in our theorem. The remaining task in the proof is to prove that the image of Tx has exactly the form given in the theorem. We can accomplish this by first proving that the sequence EK of the eigenvectors forms an orthonormal basis of the range of the operator T. Since the sequence of EKs is orthonormal by construction, the theory of basis of Hilbert spaces tells us that it is sufficient to prove that an element Y in the range of T can be orthogonal to every vector EK in the orthonormal set only if it is exactly the zero vector. The proof of this property is presented in detail in the lecture notes. And after we have verified that EKs form an orthonormal basis of the range of T, we will in particular know that every element Y in the range has the generalized Fourier series expansion, where Y is expressed as an either finite or infinite linear combination of EKs, and the coefficients are precisely the inner products between Y and EK. The generalized Fourier series expansion of the elements in the range of T allows us to complete our proof by showing that Tx has exactly the claimed form. Indeed, if we take an arbitrary x, then Tx, being in the range of T, can be written using the Fourier series expansion. We can then modify the inner products in the coefficients by using the self-adjointness of T to move the operator T to the second component of the inner product. But since EK is an eigenvector of T, TK is exactly equal to lambda K times EK. And in the final step, we just take the real eigenvalue lambda K out of the inner product and arrive at exactly the expression of Tx that we were looking for. One of the consequences of the spectral theorem is that for a non-zero lambda, which is not an eigenvalue of T, the solution x of the linear equation lambda I minus T x equal to y can be represented using the eigenvalues and orthonormal eigenvectors of T. More precisely, for a non-zero lambda which is not equal to any of the lambda k's in the spectral decomposition, and for any vector y, the equation has a unique solution which has the form given in the statement of the theorem. Here the second part of the expression is again a linear combination of the eigenvectors EK, but with suitably modified scalings of the terms. In the case where all the eigenvalues of T are non-zero, it is possible to simplify this expression further, but in the general case, the presented formula also takes into account the possible zero eigenvalue of T, which does not appear in the original spectral decomposition of T. This formula for the solution of a linear equation can in particular be applied in solving integral equations. Here we again study the Fredholm integral equation of the second kind and assume the kernel K is separable and consists of two terms having particular forms. We assume that the constants beta 1 and beta 2 are real and the functions k1 and k2 are uniformly continuous and linearly independent. By dividing both sides of the integral equation with mu, we can write our integral equation as a linear operator equation with lambda being equal to 1 over mu, y being equal to the function g divided by mu, and x corresponding to the solution f of the integral equation. As in our earlier examples, the operator t is the compact integral operator with the kernel k, and our assumptions on the form of the kernel also imply that t is self-adjoint. We already studied the process of computing the non-zero eigenvalues and eigenvectors of an integral operator, and now we can use this process together with the spectral theorem to solve the original integral equation. The process is simple. If we start with the original integral equation with a separable kernel, we begin by computing the non-zero eigenvalues of the integral operator as solutions of the finite dimensional eigenvalue problem. Since the kernel is assumed to be consisting of two linearly independent terms, the eigenvalue problem is two-dimensional, and as before, the elements of the coefficient matrix A are given by suitable L2 inner products of K1 and K2. Because of the structure of K, the matrix A has one or two real non-zero eigenvalues. These eigenvalues are precisely the non-zero eigenvalues of T, which are also part of the spectral decomposition. And when we normalize the corresponding eigenvectors of T, we will also find the two vectors E1 and E2 in the spectral decomposition. If A happens to have a repeated eigenvalue, we need to specifically choose orthogonal eigenvectors, but otherwise E1 and E2 are orthogonal by construction. In the second step, we can apply our formula for the solution x of the linear equation to compute the solution of our original integral equation. If we apply this formula with lambda equal to 1 over mu and y equal to g divided by mu, we arrive at an explicit formula for the solution f of the integral equation. The solution has three terms, the last two terms both consisting of the eigenfunction Ej of t, which is multiplied with scalars depending on mu and the corresponding eigenvalues lambda j, as well as the L2 inner product between g and Aj. As we can see, the solution is complete since all parts of f can be computed either analytically or numerically based on the parameter mu, the function g, and the parameters of the kernel of the integral equation.